nation and then remain standing for that after that for the pledge.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, creator of heaven and earth, we come before you this day with spirit of humility and gratitude, thanking you, God, for all of your bountiful blessings upon each of us. We ask a special blessing on this municipal government, our state government, our federal government. We ask for your guidance and discretion as the business of this city is handled by our representation. We thank you for your direction. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
In the State House, there were a couple of bills.
bills that didn't make it out of committee about coal ash on bills 387 and 388, which would require the notification of the public if coal ash from any of the 29 coal ash ponds that Georgia Power has closed. They have 8 to 10 million tons of coal ash that they have to get rid of. And there were bills in the legislature that would require public notification and things like that, and they didn't make it out of committee. Georgia Power has urgency to get rid of this poison. Coal ash has in it mercury and arsenic and molybdenum and beryllium and lots of horrible stuff. We already have enough water problems around here that we need to add on to it, that we're poisoning our own water by putting coal ash into our landfill. So my request would be that while there's a retreat and looking at what ordinances we have, then you add on to that that the Valesta community isn't interested in having coal ash added to our landfill. Then I'd also be curious about, I know that we have some coal ash in our landfill already. I'd like to know what has gone into our landfill, and could we be notified when coal ash comes to our landfill? I mean, if there's not a state law that says they have to notify us, could we have a local something that says we get to be notified when poison comes to our landfill? And then the last thing is that it didn't make out of committee. They referred that legislation to a study committee. And if you could help to get Dexter Sharper onto that study committee, then our voice here in South Georgia would be heard on the study committee, because we sort of know that Lana and many places think that nobody lives here and we're really not very important and they'd like to just throw their trash out here. So if we could have our voice on that study committee, that would be really great. Thank you.
Will any other citizens be heard?
Hi, my name is Sally Turner-Queerin. This is the first time I've ever spoken. Now bear with me, I'm very nervous. Do I need to give my address?
Yes, give me your address and you need to not waste any time.
Okay, 1121 Lakeshore Drive. I'm a member of the Historic Preservation Commission, but I'm also a citizen of Valdosta, and I just wanted to make a couple of points about that we talked about earlier. The historic district is not established until 1980, so the way the building looks now is very different, but it was built as a companion building for the other brick foremost stairway right across the street. And remind you that the front of the building was on William Street, not Ashley. So the back of the building looks like the back of the building. And I want to remind you that it is at the edge of the VSU campus. And VSU only has south and the east to move forward, and I just think that they will be looking in those areas for development in the future. And then also wanted to remind you that the original request was only to demolish the historic part of the building. The two-bay garage, the modern addition, was not part of that request. So what we will have left is a two-bay garage with a parking area on Ashley Street. So I hope this will come back again for them to demolish the two-bay garage, and maybe they can build something that would be nice and beautiful on Ashley Street. And then also, Councilman, yes, I appreciate your comments and wanted to say that at the point where something goes back and forth in the appeal process, that maybe at some point we need to have a structural assessment done so that we can kind of better gauge what is involved in the renovation or restoration of these buildings. So, thank you very much.
Are there any other citizens to be heard?
Mayor, Council, my name is Eric Howard, 2519 David Drive. I'd just like each and every one of us in this room to take a time and think back to when we decided to purchase our house. Some of us decided to purchase a house close to the city because we were going to be active and with our kids, take them back just for convenience. Some of us decided to build
George Foster, 95004 Oak Drive, Valdosta, Georgia. Many council just have comments most of them, but I was watching Facebook today and I saw a dead cat in on the highway. And there was a circle of turkeys. You saw it just walking around that cat. It was like it was a religious ceremony. And a lot of people across the nation was commenting about that. And they were saying, what's going on there? And so it seems to me that the divine source is telling us, can't we all just get along? Can't we all just have a little love for one another? Can't we just look at life and death as one day we're going to cross that same city hall or something like that? And so I have to admit that it touched me because I cover a lot of cities and counties in what I do. And so I came this evening to say to you all, I want to thank you all for serving the city in your elected positions. I work in cities wherein there are at least 3 council people and a civilian that died from the stress that was thrust upon them. And one of the 10 plus 2 was also dead now, because she too was under stress and she was a lupus patient. So I can only imagine what you all are going through. When I sit down sometimes with people who drink coffee with me, but they don't agree with me, and they often criticize the work that you all have done, and I do too sometimes, but my God, I let up sometimes, so you all can breathe. So I just want you to know that. You may not get it much, but I do appreciate it, and I believe a lot of people in the city appreciate what you all are doing, and because after all, when you go home, you have families and children that you love, just like we love ours. So I just want to thank you for doing what you do, because a lot of people who down on you for the work that you may or may not be doing, they won't even run for office.
Let's give Jordan.
Thank you. Thank you.
And George, you had to come and see me lately, but I'd like to talk to you about a couple of
items. Hey, Mr. Mayor, Allison. J.D. Rice, 501 Mountain View Drive, Austin, Georgia. Mr. Mayor, Council, I'd like for us to find out if, in fact, they operate hazardous waste to our landfill. I know that it's not permitted for that, but I'm just told that they're breaking material over from Ware County, dumping it in our landfill. They are in violation of the EPA Superfund Act. So I'm concerned about that. They don't need to let us know what they're bringing to our landfill so we can you know, stay on top of it. Echo what George said. I applaud you on your truck buyback proposals, but let's not put it on Smith Avenue. Thank you.
Oh, don't worry about that. Yeah. All right, any other citizens to be heard?
Hi there.
Hi.
John Portman, Sebastian, by the Portland Road. I do get my mail in the city, 3338 Country Club Road, number L336. I had to explain that to the driver's license office yesterday when I had my renewal. I'm here tonight as president of the Walls Watershed Coalition. Got an email from the Watershed organization in this area. And since December, we also are known as Suwannee River Keeper and deal with the rivers all the way down the Gulf. In fact, one of the reasons that Walls was formed in 2012 was because of the Valdosta wastewater situation, because there were complaints coming all the way up from Citrus County and Eaton County. And you've all already seen news about that. Thank you, sir.
You've already seen news.
This is one example of this is the fourth resolution that I've obtained so far from Florida counties downstream. Now, I hasten to add, when I say I'm just collecting the set. I had nothing to do with putting them up to this. I had nothing to do with getting these resolutions passed. I'm just collecting them and talking to you about them tonight. And I can't, you know, read their minds, but it's pretty clear what they're talking about here. Just let me pick out that they're talking specifically say, for basically end use. That's a big problem with this county's downstream. There is a lot of people who live there, because it's the Samani River. So they all stay in Florida to step in, and they wonder to do what? Well, I have a suggestion. I've heard the Austin staff about how it's cleaner downstream from the wastewater plant and upstream. Okay, well, what if the contamination is coming from some other source? What if the state of Florida that institutes and pays for regular water quality monitoring, frequent, regular, not just when there's a spill, and space along the river so they can find out where this stuff is coming from? I would also recommend that Valdosta perhaps might consider having independent third-party water quality monitoring, independent as in not even supervised by the city of Valdosta, so nobody's afraid if there are any results that Valdosta doesn't like, they might have a problem. So that's my suggestion for you tonight, and there's four of these that I've seen much like this. There's three more that either haven't passed all of such a 3 minutes up, and I will answer one question.
Yes?
I know this might surprise you, but we are monitoring that situation continuously right now, and all it does is prove that we are right. The water that comes from the north end of the county is dirtier than the water that leaves the wastewater treatment plant here. Now, when that water gets to the county line, to the state line down there, it's picked up, as you can imagine. Fertilizer, animal feces, and all that. And by the time it gets to the state line, it's dirtier than it is when it leaves our, much dirtier than when it leaves our plant. So we're doing everything we can, John, to make sure that we know that we have all our information correct. And we're monitoring that situation on a continuous basis now, not just when we have a spill. So we'd be glad to furnish you with those facts and figures. I understand that, and thank you. However, they know you said it's fixed last summer and still spills. You see the credibility issue.
We haven't had any spill. We had the one problem with the new plant that was not our fault. We spent $58 million on that plant, and the people that designed it and built it were at fault, and they corrected it, so that's not going to be another problem.
I applaud your efforts. I'm just pointing out this credibility problem downstream. I made suggestions.
Well, they might blame somebody else, that's for sure.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. All right, any other citizens to be heard, please come forward and state your name.
My name is William Worstel, Thomas County, Georgia. I would just like to read you all a few things. Annually, we burn 105 billion tons of coal. 55% of that goes through what they call a baghouse and cat house. It's a catalytic converter. Baghouse where they catch the residues. Those residues are used in concrete construction, making blocks, asphalt, etc., etc. What you have to worry about is what they call potash. Out of that 105 billion tons, 109 tons will contain mercury, 7,884 will contain arsenic, 1,167 tons of selenium. Albany does not have a solid waste permit, therefore they're shipping their coal ash to you. Coal ash has been deregulated down to a solid waste. It's not hazardous waste. So as far as that man's question goes about hazardous waste being dumped in your landfill, yes it is.
It's not our landfill, right? We do not own that landfill. It's owned by a private company, and we dump just like everybody else, so that's not, we don't control that.
Well, I'm just, yeah, I was just one of
the
things
will,
know that there's a whole lot of
brand that to zero to
your way. Okay.
Thank you. Any other citizens to be heard?
time to go over the minutes from our February 23rd meeting. In that case, have you seen any additions or deletions that we need to make to those minutes at this time? Hearing none, the minutes will be approved by acclamation. Ladies and gentlemen, we have two public hearing items tonight. Both of these items, the person that's presenting them will have time to do that, and then if any opposition or affirmation for these two projects will be given a chance to speak. The total time for the presentation and the speaking, you'll be given 15 minutes. So each side will be given 15 minutes. So try to keep that in mind when you're up here speaking and everything. So at this time, Matt, I'm going to call on you to make the first presentation.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mayor. This first public hearing item is a plan development request by Crown Real Estate Development. This is property, you may recall that it was rezoned 3 months ago. It is located at 2107 Main Street Road, currently zoned community commercial, and consists of 7.42 acres. It's immediately next to I-75, immediately south of the Grove Apartments, and across Main Street Road from the Drury Development Property. Comprehensive plan-wise, Community Activity Center is its character area. This is a fairly intensive commercial-type activity center, in this case very similar to the Mosta Mall area around exit 18. This is an older aerial, which is in your packet on the screen, which shows the land as it looked prior to the apartments and prior to the Drury Development in the south. This is from about 6 years ago. Currently, the subject property looks like this. It is vacant. That is the Grove Apartments there in the background. This is how it looks from the west. I-75 is just a maintained clear lot. This is the former Elks Lodge property. I-75 nearly to the west. A little better view of the Grove Apartments. And then there's also a small apartment complex immediately to the east of Main Street Road. The master plan is in your packet. It's a proposal to develop this as 5 buildings of mixed use. That is why it is needing a plan development. They're proposing a commercial and multifamily to share the same building. And like we talked about in the work session, if the uses were not in the same building, and the applicant was wanting to put these on separate parcels, we would not even be talking about plan development. But the proposal is to build this in phases, total of about 140 dwelling units, 45,000 square feet of commercial space, plenty of parking to satisfy all this extra parking. In the larger building on the lower right part of the screen, that is a 5-level parking deck. The inspiration for the project was an existing similar type development that is built out in Calabasas called College Town. It is near that Bushy City. That's a little bit of a picture of it. As we talked about our rezoning case 3 months ago, they had told us that they were considering to be back as a plan development for a mixture of the uses of commercial and multifamily. That's why they are here. Lanes pattern, overall, the zoning map really tells the picture. To the north is multifamily, to the south is commercial. They're wanting to do both on the same development, and they're right here in the middle. Planning Commission recommended this at the meeting on February 27th, and they're recommending approval to you with 9 conditions, defining a consistent comprehensive plan and the plan development review standards. Glad to answer questions you might have.
Questions from council? All right. All right, at this time, is there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of this request? Anyone who would like to speak in favor? Come forward and state your name.
My name is Jim Jones. I'm the architect on this project. My office is located at 1806 Plum Street. I have here with me the owner, developer, Matt King, and also the civil engineer is here.
there anyone in the audience who would like to speak in opposition to this request? Anyone who would like to speak in opposition? So, Council, I'll turn it over to you, Pastor.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
Make a motion we approve the request as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
That's with the current conditions.
Sure. I mean, that, as presented was with the conditions.
With the conditions.
We know. Okay. I need to state that because as presented.
All right. Did you have a question?
I do have a little bit of discussion, and it's not directed at the project, but what the project's going to do to the neighborhood down there. And I've said this before, I think we're overloading that short road with traffic, and I know what the traffic counts say and what the traffic counts are, but there, I have to look at the big picture. The big picture is we have vacant lots down there, wooded areas that are going to be developed in the future. That's inevitable. And I'm worried about the amount of traffic on this road and we're not going to be prepared for. We tend to wait until we have a problem to fix it when we need to make sure the problems don't occur by addressing the traffic now. So I'm just challenging the engineer and the manager, everybody to stay on top of this. Great project, it'll be good, but we can only put more traffic on that road, and then when the rest of that area is built out, we're going to have problems. We don't need to wait. We need to fix these problems and prepare for them now. Other than that, good problem.
Any further discussion? Comments? Hearing none. The motion is to approve the application, so all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed by saying aye. It is done. The motion carries. Thank you, Brad. Okay. Now, the next rezoning.
Yes, sir. This last item is a rezoning request by Mr. Darmish for property located on St. Augustine Road. It consists of 0.89 acres located at 401. This is a three-sided. Has three street frontages at front San Augustine Road by a pretty long distance. It is between Jones Avenue and Laura Street. The property, as you can see on the map, it is fairly long and not very deep. CX zoning requires a little extra setback in the front, a little extra buffer yard and extra residential, in addition to allowing some fairly intensive commercial uses. The proposal is to downzone this from CH to CC to allow a little bit more buildable area on the lot and also reduce the intensity by below the zone, which makes it a little better neighbor to the single family zoning to the east. Comprehensive plan, community activity center, which allows all the commercial zoning districts. This is an area on subject property, a clear vacant lot, has existed that way for many years. High into the east, you see the single family development that's there, as well as many of the other commercial pieces up and down St. Augustine Road. This is a conceptual, I want to emphasize the word conceptual site plan. They have prepared several of these, but it's really just to demonstrate the possibility of what the property might hold as built out as a retail center. Two buildings of about 4,500 square feet. Their preference would be to put a parking area in between the buildings. It all will boil down to the type of access they're able to get from George DOT and how they want to connect or not connect the parking to the side streets. Subject property, so clear vacant lot, is an existing fence. Here you see some of the other commercial properties along St. Augustine Road. Planning Commission reviewed this at the meeting on February 27th. They found it consistent with the comprehensive plan and recommended the approval to you. And also finding it consistent with the standards for exercises under power, and all that is articulated in every package. Glad to answer your questions tonight.
What the setback is from the east property line?
The buffer yard is what is driving that. Between CH and residential zoning, it's 30 feet. With CC zoning, it's 20 feet.
Okay, so it's an angle from the
how right.
The angle, you know, they would be 20 feet away.
Well, they have to, the buffer yard at CC zoning would be 20 feet. separate the buildings from the property line by 5 feet, so there's an extra gap in there. But the site plan that you see shows how the building, the closest that the building could be.
What are they from? When was the feet that they are going to go back on the east side back there? What is the setback?
The setback is 20 feet for CC7.
It's going to be tighter there.
It could be. This, of course, is the maximum scenario. Stormwater is under ground detention, which is an expensive proposition. If they opt to go to surface detention, it's going to open up some more space.
Thank you.
All right, is anyone in the audience who would like to speak in favor of this request? Anyone who would like to speak in favor of this request? Is anyone in the audience who would like to speak in opposition to this request? Anyone who would like to speak in opposition? All right, here's no council, I'll turn it over to you.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I make the motion that you approve the request as the case.
Second.
Motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, by same sign. Motion carries. All right, ladies and gentlemen, the next item is a request from the Valdosta Historic Preservation Commission. The way this works is the appellant, which is the person that's making the appeal, gets to speak first. And you have 15 minutes, and then the Valdosta Historic Preservation Commission will have 15 minutes for rebuttal. So at this time, whoever can make the presentation on behalf of the appellant, please come on. And you have 15 minutes.
Thank you. I hope I won't use nearly a third of that. But thank you for hearing me again on this. I don't want to repeat myself from last time. I wanted to add just a couple comments about this particular property that I didn't mention last time, and that is ever since that property was transferred over to Insta-Lube for the use of the Insta-Lube oil station, they've had problems getting in and out on Ashley Street because of its proximity to the light at the Gordon Street intersection. It stays backed up, so you can go there just about any time of the day, and you see that there's congestion on the front of that property, and it's practically impossible to get in and out of there. The current tenant that was there in January is gone because there was an inadequate parking. There was another thing I left out was there was extensive fire damage inside that building many, many years ago, I think before Insta-Lube got there. And at that time, the building probably should have been taken down, but it wasn't. They just covered it up and never have used it. To use it for its original purpose is not economically feasible at this time. It's a warehouse. The problem with the warehouse is it's about 3 to 4 feet off the grade, and the property slopes down to Ashley Street from the back of the property to the front. So it's got a number of problems with trying to use it as a warehouse. If you want to convert it to an office building, you would just have to spend a ton of money to do it. You'd have to practically rebuild the building for the sake of historical preservation at 902 North Ashley Street. If you drive up North Ashley Street, can you honestly say that taking down that warehouse is going to significantly change the historical character of the neighborhood? Because that's the standard we live by. And if it doesn't significantly change the historical character of 902 Ashley Street, or that block, the 900 block, if you're familiar with that, you'll understand what I'm saying. If it doesn't significantly change the historical character and detract from it, then we should be allowed to take the building down. And I'm asking the council today to vote to allow us to take that building down.
Okay. All right. Did the
three specific three areas in their application that where they claim that the HPC failed to follow the guidelines with respect to the three areas: historical significance, the economic feasibility of a historical restoration, and the impact of demolition on the surrounding area's historical character. I'm going to go through each one of these items and hopefully try to shed some light on how why that is not why we don't agree with that. So starting with the historical significance, that's a question that comes up often. What makes a property historically significant? This property has been deemed as a contributing property in the local historic district. A lot of research goes into that. Professionals are hired to help the city. This was done several years ago when they are actually trying to create the district. And they identify each building that is contributing. It takes a lot of time. The process is very extensive to actually create a historic district. I know the current chair of the National Historic Register in the state of Georgia, and we've seen cases that the communities spent more than 10 years in trying to actually come up with that district and to be able to properly document and research every single contributing property. So going back to the question, what makes this specific building historically significant, or why is it considered contributing? Three elements. We look at the age, integrity, and the significance. The property has to be old enough to be considered historic. In general, it has to be at least 50 years old. In this condition, this building was built probably in the 40s. We know that the foremost dailies existed back in 1952. So the building was built before then. And let's assume it was built in the early 50s. The building's at least 65 years old. So the criteria number one is met. Number two, integrity. And the way you look at that is, you look at the building and you try to identify elements, events, architectural, significant architectural elements, everything that links that building to its historic era. Whether that building is a defining, historically defining element, or it represents that era. This clearly, from so many different levels, it does. Just by the fact what it actually contained, the foremost dairies, that identifies the building's history very specifically. It ties it back to its history. I can go on and on, but that's one of the elements we look at. Significance, it's defined in three ways. That's again similar to integrity. So it's defined by events, by embodying the distinctive physical and spatial characteristics of an architectural style, or by having the potential to yield information important to understanding the past of our community. And I'm going to go back, sorry, for integrity. We also look at how impact the building is still. So if you look at the building, does it still encompass that original feel, the character, the historic integrity of that building? For each one of these criteria, it's a check, yes, yes, yes. Otherwise, this building would not have been considered a contributing element. So this is as far as the first question, the historical significance. It is absolutely a contributing building. This is a historic building, it is part of the historic district. The next item is the economic feasibility. Okay, so economic feasibility is very difficult to really talk about without proper assessment. So if we want to take that route, we would have liked to see an actual, some sort of an assessment to that regard. So for example, a reasonable economic return is determined through looking at, was the owner aware of the fact that this is a historic building at the time of purchase? What is the current economic return and financial liability have been pulled out. So therefore, the integrity of that street is lost because we have just taken out buildings. We have so many of these examples here in our town, Van Basten. Patterson Street used to be called Millionaire's Row. That's before buildings were removed and we have in their place other type of structures. I'm not saying that this is a Millionaire's Row, but yes, this building is carved, does form a very specific edge on the corner of William Street, which is a historic street. This is the beginning of another historic district in town. So there's an overlap in there. I can go on and on about that. So in summary, the three items that were highlighted in here, we don't agree that these three items, the HBC failed to follow the guidelines specifically in these three items. And lastly, which is something I said before, again, I believe I've heard you all agree that HBC, which is what you're all here trying to decide, did the HBC abuse its discretion in denying this request, this application? And so I hope you are all in agreement with what the HBC has done twice. The staff is also recommending denial. I hope I have tried to shed some light on these criteria, but if you have any questions, I would be glad to take any of those questions at this time. And thank you again for the opportunity to listen to us one more time.
Does council have any questions? Leading your part.
I have a question for staff. If this request for the appeal is denied, when can the applicant bring the request back to you?
Our ordinance suggests that we wait 6 months before the request is reheard by the Historic Preservation Commission once they have denied. It's not exactly set in stone, but it represents that we take a 6 month break from having it reheard, unless there is a substantial change in the application. So if the application were to change, for instance, there's no longer demolition, but there was rehabilitation proposed, then it could come immediately back to the Historic Preservation Commission.
Okay. So my next question is, if they were to go ahead and tear this building down, what would happen? If we denied it tonight, the appeal, and then next week they tear the building down, what would happen?
I'm not exactly sure that what I would be able to tell you tonight would be the exact process that would happen. I can give you my opinion of what I understand to be the process. The first action that would happen is a city marshal would appear at the site with the stop work order and stop the demolition. Then there would be a $250 fine that would be issued to the person working without a permit. And then the city marshal would set up a court date for a municipal court hearing where the applicant would not be able to do any more work at that point since the stop work was issued. And then they would go whenever the municipal court date was set up. That's the best of my understanding of the way the court.
Right. So after hearing that answer, is there anything in that answer that would possibly make them want to stop or not demolish the building because they would only have to pay $250 in a fine? You say they started at 6 o'clock one night, there isn't going to be a marshal on call for an office, and they had it demolished by the next morning. $250 isn't going to, it might be worth demolishing it and paying $250 to get the eyesore off the street. Does that make sense? So I find that that in itself is a problem. Because that is not a, that won't stop them from doing this personally. So I think the fine system's broken. I also think the system's possibly broken in that whether I or anybody else up here thinks that the property is an eyesore and possibly should be demolished, we're not here to vote on it. Well, I'm trying to get some questions answered here on what it is.
I think you got your answer.
But in your opinion, would anybody with the $250 fine or the city marshals coming out stop? Do you think that would stop them?
I wouldn't make an opinion on that.
May I interject? I think the applicants, if they wanted to go that route, they would have done that already. I appreciate the fact that they are going with the system and they're using the process to come. They have done this twice now. And I am hopeful that we will be able to reach some sort of a workable.
I do want to be clear. That question has been posed to me too, so I want to be clear.
Yeah, 2 minutes left.
Okay. I can do that. Tim's definitely a bit on this status, but I think I'm right. Okay, let's say your example. Let's say they're demolishing the building. Okay. And they do it at night. If an officer, police officer rides by and sees that, they're going to call and check with the marshal's office, call somebody. If it's determined that this council has made a decision then not to tear that building down, there will be a $250 fine associated. We would stop it from tearing that building down because of the will of this council. If they refuse and they continue to tear it down, in my opinion, that would be obstruction of a law enforcement officer. There is a charge associated with you, agree?
Well, I submit that it was a stop work order and we went out with issues on top of the injunction moving through just before if they continue to violate that, there would be a contempt of court
and the judge would what?
She would make the decision, but that would be other fines per day or incarceration.
All right, Council, we have three options on this before voting. Just to go over this, we can uphold the commission's determination upon finding that the commission did not use its discretion. We can reject the commission's determination upon finding that the commission used its discretion, or we can return the matter to the commission, which we've already done. So, hearing that, at this time, I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. Mayor, we have yet to have any case presented before us that indicates that the HPC has abused their powers. The determination of whether or not we personally believe that this is an eyesore or not an eyesore is a contributing structure or not contributing structure is irrelevant. The decision before us is whether or not Historic Preservation Commission abused its powers in the execution of its duties regarding this case, of which we clearly determined they have not. I make a motion to deny the appeal.
Second. We have a motion and a second to deny the appeal. Is there any further discussion?
Mr. Mayor, I do just want to say that I brought up those items to ask those questions because I think our system's broken. Number one, don't think the fine system's high enough, and I've said that before, to prevent someone from destroying a historic structure, whether I like it or not. I don't necessarily like this building. I personally am not sure the contribution, except for the fact that you went back through it and you've shown the history of it. And I like that, but the building has changed so much that I'm not sure that it's a great structure and looks good right there and contributes to what we hope is a beautiful downtown area. I agree with the councilman. That's not what we're voting on, and that's why I will vote that the HPC did exactly what they should do. But I think we need to, in the future, have some discussions about those parameters and look at possibly changing them. I think our hands are tied tonight, but I don't think our hands should be tied.
Any further discussion?
Well, as long as we're in discussion, but I can't help but point out that we have several buildings in downtown Boston in very poor shape, one of which the roof had totally collapsed in on. And the owner of that property could have easily said, you know what, the heck with it, let's just tear it all down and start from scratch. But no, they had vision, they had integrity, they had desire to make our historic building, our downtown, a much better place. And today we have Burgess Market at that location. Far worse shape building than this building is. So sometimes you gotta scrub a little, and you get the dirt off of it, and you can kind of shed off a pretty good thing.
Further discussion?
Absolutely.
Yes.
My thing is, the wording that the ordinance report says and how it is, it does give us a little, should I say, it's really strict. It does not give a lot of leeway for certain implication things going on with the historic preservation committee to make a decision. We have safety issues versus the situation of a change. And I have no fault of our historic preservation committee, but I think of the ordinance that we have, and it should be changed, and because it's there, I don't think we should continue to roll. Should I say, if one thing is already not fixed, we should not continue to follow in that area. It's not fixed, we're going to continue. And I understand what you're saying about one person fixing something in the district because one person decided to do one thing like that. That's good, but all things are going to be right back in our visions. And we understand that. So, because of the fact is, I feel that the wording in our ordinance is so strict and does not give us the leeway. We should make some adjustments, and that's going to have to happen at a later time. At that time, I said it's not good, and I don't move on it, so I will not be voting.
Any further discussion?
Just clarification for the record, you're voting to deny the appeal between the upholding the commission's determination, correct?
That's correct. All right, does everybody understand that? So when I call a question, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand and leave them up where I can get a camera. So all in favor of the motion as stated, which is to uphold the commission's determination, raise your right hand. All right, of course. Okay, all opposed by same sign. Well, y'all put that in my hand. For some reason, I had a sneaking feeling that this would happen. And that was confirmed when one of our councilmen said he wouldn't be here tonight. I've been to this building. I've been in it numerous times over the years. And quite honestly, my feeling is the building has not been maintained, it has not been kept up, it's not the original historic building that it was. It's been painted. The building next door is red brick, which I think is a beautiful historic building. The door on one side of it, which has been changed. Somebody put stone around the door and installed a modern glass door. And none of these things have ever, been noticed, I guess. I don't know whether they have or not. But anyway, of course, one of my main things is to make sure that we change our ordinances to reflect today's situations and today's times. And because of all those reasons, I'm going to have to vote nay on the motion to uphold the commission's report and the commission's findings. So the motion fails. I voted nay. So the motion fails 4-3.
and a second. Is there any discussion on this?
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
As much as I appreciate exactly what you said and the councilman said in his motion, I agree with you that the building doesn't look good, and I'm not sure it shouldn't be torn down. That's not the issue. The issue is exactly what was stated. Did they abuse their authority? And they did not, absolutely did not abuse their authority, because they went by what we have in place, what we, this body, helped put in place and keep it that way.
We voted on a motion, though, Robert, which was legal, and that motion was defeated.
And I understand that. I'm not a stupid person.
I understand. No.
But what I disagree with you was when you stated your reasons for voting the way you voted, that wasn't what we were voting on. What we were voting on was, and what you just told those people sitting right there, is that they abused their power. And they did not abuse their power per the regulations. Very clear. Makes common sense. They did not abuse their powers. I'm not in disagreement with
feeling,
you.
My feeling was that they should have been willing to work with the customer a little bit more. In other words, this building is not going to, the feeling I have is this building is not going to change. If it stays there, it's going to stay vacant, and it's going to be dilapidated, and it's going to fall in, and I think something needs to be done.
I don't disagree with you, Mayor. I don't disagree with you, Sonny, and the others who voted for. I don't. But that's where we have to go back and fix this problem.
I agree with that.
But that was not what we were asked to do tonight.
We voted that motion down. We've got to take action on this item. That's what our attorney is advising us to do at this time.
Oh, I
wow. I'd like to call the question.
Let me clarify, Councilman Vickers, your motion is to reject the commission's determination. Item number two.
My motion is to grant the request of the applicant. We the council, we set the rules, and I'm here. We should have 20 years of tied council meetings. And we are elected to make set policy and make decisions. So I call the question, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. All right, his motion was to reject the commission's determination. So is there any further discussion?
Services. However, Urban Environmental Services
fact, the second lowest bid of $12,000. During the month of October, we conducted a trial period which Diversified Industries and Urban Environmental Services, they contracted those areas, both of those zones, and which they showed that they could do the work in a building period. So what we would like now, if we would like to move forward and recommend that council approve the low bid of Diversified Industries for Zone A and Environmental Services for Zone B, and allow the city to contract with them for the time period specified. In doing so, with this contract, what it would do, it would free up some of our manpower from those areas, and we could concentrate on some of the other right-of-way areas throughout the city. Glad to answer any questions.
This consists of West Hood Avenue, and East Hood Avenue, and South Patterson, and all down the road. That was that?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now, what, Massenheim, Griffin Avenue, it's state route, but they are not included in it.
That is absolutely correct. We looked at those areas, and based off of the funding, we went with these areas, and as we move forward, we will take another look at Madison Avenue and Airport Road.
But Councilman Pickers, we do feel that, like as Richard said, if we have our own steps up, we can get those areas more often. It's our plan.
All right, any other questions for Richard on this topic?
How do I make that determination? We should carry the amount, how much miles was in those areas to clean up?
What we did, we looked at the funding that was available and to make our decision with that. And then also we took, as I said earlier, as we put those areas would be contracted, that would free up that manpower, and we'll be able to concentrate on those other areas just as much as those areas would be mowed by the contractor itself.
And another reason we intentionally chose West Hill and East Hill Avenue, as we discussed Tuesday evening, that's a state route. Property owners do not have to mow through the right of way. So now that was one of the intentions we did for this group to come in and be able to do that.
I'm just wondering, they are all within, should I say, interest to the city, and I just think that we look at the east and west, north, and now the south side, that some reason that one wasn't included. And I'm just wondering what you would probably determine that you would not use
South Patterson's part.
All the way to the bridge, all the way to the
bridge. And again, I just want to point out, Richard mentioned this takes us to June 30th. You'll see if this again, we start to present the budget, we'll have some more updated numbers, maybe include some other routes as well.
Yes, because I know that you forget the new high school area coming in, that's an interest also.
Right, just please keep in mind we're doing this because we feel West Hill Avenue is our biggest time consumer. It's going to free up our staff now a lot to put some of
that. Keep it up there.
That's right. Because I have to admit, we're hitting 3 or 4 weeks the best we can do during the growing season. So, and these contracts are weekly, so I want to point that out as well.
All right. Any other questions, Richard, on that? Did I have a motion then to on the two Zone A and Zone B bids?
Make a motion to approve as presented.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, by same sign. Bid none. Motion carries.
City manager?
Just a few items.
Yeah.
Just wanted to remind everybody this is Stella Avenue. Next week will be closed down starting Tuesday for some road repair close to the bridge there. Pat has crew did a great job on choosing next week because the problem is out. So we try to be able to, you know, put that to an end for us. The lines of retreat next Friday, March 17th. Ms. Shirley says she will have the package to you tomorrow, but don't expect them at 8:30. She was reminded that the day goes to 5 o'clock, so maybe a little bit later in the day when you get your package. But we will get those to you tomorrow. Just a reminder about the Zia City Festival Saturday. So I'm going to have a city booth there, so share our booth. Also today, it's our understanding that MLK Paving
was complete. So we'll be going to the next phase of decorative lighting with George Bauer. And then just going to go to the calendar, our next bulk trash amnesty day is April 22nd. As you know, that's turned out to be a very successful and popular program. We're going to add the collection of tires this time around to it because that's been requested. Just as long as we don't get more than 1,500 tires for our week, we'll be okay. So we are going to take tires. There's going to be a few little restrictions like, you know, four per person because Richard only has the capacity for so much, but it's a start in the right direction for that. That's it, Mayor.
That's it. Council comments.
When will you have that?
The bulk trash amnesty at the four locations we've always had, but we're only going to collect tires at Myrtle Street.
Yes, I think it'll surprise everybody, but I do want to commend the hospital authority for their actions this week. It is about time. It was a year ago this month that I brought this item to the council at the retreat. We've had some major changes in their administration, and I commend them for that. This is the problem. They need to look in the mirror and see the dirt on their own faces and resign, all of them. They have allowed everything that has happened to happen, and they played the two administrators that were fired as the patsies. But they had to approve everything that happened in that hospital under those two gentlemen's watch. So I will state one more time, every member, not only ours, but the county's members of the hospital authority should resign, and that should clean the house. That should take care of the business at hand of making our hospital work for the people of this county. That's it.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
I can't help but, especially considering that we have some brave public servants sitting in the audience tonight, to say this, but in my experience over the last 19 years I've been in this seat, this makes the third time we've told those diligent, hardworking souls that their opinion and adherence to the code that have been adopted don't mean a thing. We have politicized three times different issues involving the Historic Preservation Commission. And it's been my experience that whenever you use politics to make policy decisions and looking long term, typically get the short end of the stick. I'm surprised they haven't all resigned. Because it would certainly demoralize all the effort and time and training and learning all there is to learn about historic preservation and how you go about doing it. But I'm going to shut up and I'm just going to say thank you for all that y'all do. And I'm sorry that sometimes politics get in the way.
Any other comments? All right, in that case, I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Do I have a second? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.